My name is Elliot Chu, and I'm the Interim Dean of the College of Science at the University of Arizona. This will be our 16th year of doing the College of Science lecture series, and our topic this time will be on water. Life on Earth depends upon water and organics. The cosmic origins of these on Earth is actually a long-standing mystery, and today we're going to try to understand why and where those materials came from. Today's lecture is called Water Beyond Earth. Our two lecturers are Jessica Barnes and Pierre Hanekor. Both of them are assistant professors in the Department of Lunar and Planetary Science at the University of Arizona. Jess came to the University of Arizona in 2019 and is the recipient of the NASA Planetary Science Early Career Award. Pierre also came to the University of Arizona in 2019 and is the recipient of the Meteoritical Society Early Career Scientist Award. They are going to concentrate on the University of Arizona's mission to Bennu aboard a spacecraft called OSIRIS-REx. And hopefully, at the end of the lecture, you'll understand how water came to the Earth.
My name is Jessica Barnes, and this is Pierre Hanekor. We're both assistant professors at the Lunar and Planetary Laboratory at the University of Arizona. Our talk is the first in this College of Science lecture series on water, and today we're going to talk about the cosmic origins of water. Now, water is essential for life as we know it. Together, hydrogen and oxygen make up about 75% of the human body. Equally important is the element carbon. Carbon makes up about 18% of the human body. Not only is life built from water and carbon and depends on those elements to survive, but as we look at the world around us, we see that these elements are everywhere. From the water-filled oceans that cover about 70% of the Earth's surface, to the biomass that is composed of about 50% carbon. Now, as humans, we're naturally curious beings, and so we're interested in knowing the origins of these bioessential elements. We know that hydrogen and helium were created in the Big Bang, and that all of the other elements were created in many generations of stars that lived and died before our solar system was formed. Once those elements were present in the solar system, they undertook a complex journey to get to our planet, and that is the voyage we will embark on today. Although we are most familiar with water at the surface, Earth's water is distributed between different reservoirs: the hydrosphere, which includes the atmosphere, the crust, which is the rock we're all living on, and the mantle and core, which are deep beneath our feet, out of sight. Water inside our planet is locked up in minerals, not as free fluid or ice. Scientists think that the Earth's interior contains between 1 and 7 oceans worth of water, and that that resides in the mantle of our planet, where an Earth ocean is equivalent to 1.35 times 10 to the 18 metric tons of water. And that's a lot of water. And it raises important questions about where that water came from and when it got to Earth. Unraveling this history of Earth's water is not straightforward, however. And this is because the Earth's earliest record has largely been erased through the action of geological activities like plate tectonics. But some of the rocks brought up from the deep interior do allow us to get hints as to how that water got there and where it's from. Before we discuss Earth's water heritage, we need to review a little bit about how the planet was actually formed. Our solar system began with the collapse of a molecular cloud, a large cloud composed of dust and gas from the interstellar medium. That cloud collapsed into a disk that we call the solar nebula, with most of its mass concentrated in the sun at its center. During that time, water was present both as water vapor and also as ices, and water also condensed onto the surface of pre-existing dust grains. Hydrogen was also present, locked up into carbon-rich organic molecules that were likely inherited from the interstellar medium in the molecular cloud. From the disk, the planetary bodies were formed by collisions, accumulations of dust and pebble-sized objects, and the Earth was constructed from these really ancient materials. So how do we actually trace the origin of water in the Earth-forming region? Well, cosmochemists, like Pierre and myself, view the solar system as a sort of crime scene. The bodies in the solar system preserve clues to solving this mystery. That's because different solar system objects retain unique fingerprints of the history of water and organics that they contain. Our work revolves around using extraterrestrial samples to read these fingerprints and piece together this cosmic history. The fingerprints we actually use are isotopes. Now, isotopes are just atoms of the same element with the same number of protons, but different numbers of neutrons in the nucleus. We use the ratios of isotopes of the same element to describe the separation of isotopes of different mass from each other. This separation, which we also call fractionation, can be directly linked to different geological and chemical processes. For tracing the history of water, we're most interested in the 4 isotope systems you see here, most crucial of which are the isotopes of hydrogen and heavier deuterium. So these isotope ratios are essentially our fingerprints to understanding 4.5 billion years worth of solar system history. This is an artist illustration of what we think the solar nebula looked like at the time Jupiter was growing. In this simple model, the sun heats up all the material closest to it, meaning that the light elements are kept in the gas phase. These hot temperatures mean that metal and rock were the materials condensing in these regions. Further out in the disk, however, temperatures are colder, which allowed gas containing hydrogen and oxygen to condense water ice. The temperature transition between where ice was stable and ice wasn't is called the snow line. Broadly speaking, the inner solar system was dominated by molecular hydrogen gas containing very little deuterium, while the outer parts of the solar system, where ice was condensing, contained a lot of deuterium. The two main types of objects that record this early evolution of water are primitive water-rich objects, like asteroids and comets. We call them primitive because they've essentially been unchanged since their formation around 4.5 billion years ago. Therefore, they provide snapshots of what the solar nebula was like during the time that they formed.
As leftovers of planet formation, water-rich asteroids are prime candidates to investigate the origin of water and organics in the early solar system. However, they are really far away from the Earth in the asteroid belt, so we can't easily go get pieces of these asteroids. But we are fortunate that some water-rich asteroids get dislodged from the asteroid belt and make their way to the Earth's crossing orbit. And if their orbit intercepts with the Earth, they can enter the Earth's atmosphere and can be seen, if you are lucky, in the night sky as bright fireballs crossing the sky. Some of this material are coherent enough to withstand atmospheric entry and crash into the Earth's surface. Those are called meteorites. Large enough meteorites create large impact crater into the Earth's surface. One of the most famous one is Meteor Crater in northern Arizona. Meteors fall all over the Earth's surface. Because about 70% of the Earth's surface is covered in water, most fall into the oceans, but they are often found in environments where they look out of places. This is due to the fact that heating during atmospheric entry cause their surface to melt, creating a black crust of glassy material. This makes them easy to spot in hot sandy desert or in the ice field in Antarctica. NASA sends expedition of scientists every year to Antarctica to recover meteorites from ice fields. These constitute three asteroid samples, and some of these originated from water and carbon-rich asteroids. These water-rich asteroids are what we call rubble pile asteroids that were not heated sufficiently to melt. They are essentially the equivalent of sedimentary rocks from the early solar system and represent aggregate of material from planet formation, including dust, ice, and some of the first solid to form in the solar system. These samples from these asteroids that are recovered on Earth are what we call chondritic meteorites or chondrites and represent building blocks of our planets. So then the question is, what's next? How can we study them in the lab and what can we learn from them? We study them using a variety of analytical techniques to unravel their histories, including their isotope fingerprints, in order to place them in the wider context of solar system formation. This is a cross-section of one of those chondrites. As you can see, all the larger centimeter-sized objects are surrounded by dark, fine-grained material called matrix. This matrix material is very small, typical grain sizes between a human cell and a grain of sand. This is the material that most of the bioessential elements like water and carbon are found locked up in minerals and organic molecules. So the combination of their really small size and intimate mixture make it extremely challenging to unravel their signatures and histories. This amazing tool allows us to measure isotopes at scale on the order of about 50 to 100 nanometers in size, which for comparison is roughly equivalent to the size of the COVID-19 virus. By measuring different isotope systems using the nanosims, we can pair back in time into our solar system origin by investigating what happened in stars, for example, in the molecular cloud, the different events that happen in the solar nebula or in the protoplanetary disk, up to the building of planets, and finally, even geological events that are happening today. We measure hydrogen and carbon isotopes to trace the origin of water and organics in this cosmic environment. Comets and water-rich asteroids also preserve complex organic molecules, making them likely candidates to the delivery of all bioessential elements for life on Earth. As an example, we can use this type of instrument to probe the hydrogen isotopic composition of water in planetary material. We can compare the isotopic composition of water in rocks from the Earth's mantle with what we measure in water-rich meteorites. Note that we usually talk about bulk meteorite composition, which is a combination of hydrogen trapped both in minerals and in organics. This helps us understand when and from which material Earth gained its water. The current thinking is that Earth may have gained its water from three possible sources. The first one is material from the inner solar system, inside of the snow line. In that scenario, the Earth accreted water in its own building blocks. The second potential source is water-rich asteroids that accreted outside of the snow line and likely accreted abundant dust and little ice. The last candidate are comets that form in the far reaches of our solar system and, like dirty snowballs, are composed of abundant ice and a little dust. Unlike water that predominantly reflect processing in the inner and outer solar system, the hydrogen isotope showed us that organics were inherited from the cold environment in the interstellar medium, where they formed by high-energy irradiation of ices on the surface of dust grain. Hydrogen and carbon in these ices were transformed into complex organic molecules like amino acids that we think are among the base of life on Earth. Other organics also have composition suggesting that they interacted with liquid water on asteroids. On water-rich asteroids, the water was originally accreted as ice. But internal heating on asteroids during the first tens of millions of years of solar system allowed the ice to melt, creating free fluids on bodies. This fluid activity is recorded in the presence of hydrated minerals that make up the matrix of this material. The hydrogen isotopic composition of meteorite reflects the intimate mixture of these minerals with organic matter. The composition of organics was also modified by the interaction with water, causing isotopic fractionation. Jessica and I used the nanosims to unravel their history.
While meteorites provide us with crucial information on the evolution of water and carbon in our solar system, there are more than 60,000 chondritic meteorites, and we don't know their exact source, asteroids. This really hinders our ability to place them in the broader context of our solar system. Imagine picking up a pebble from the bed of the Colorado River and then trying to retrace exactly where that pebble came from. This is the complexity of meteoritics, the study of meteorites. What better way to study asteroids than actually going to one and collecting samples from the surface so that you can get the geological context? In addition, meteorites have been altered from their original states, either through the action of them coming through the atmosphere or in the environments in which they fall into when they're on the Earth's surface. Return samples have the upper hand in that we can control the environments in which those samples see. We can control the temperature, humidity, atmosphere the samples are exposed to, in order to preserve as best as possible their asteroidal chemistries. For the first time, NASA has decided to visit a carbon-rich asteroid with the goal of bringing some of that pristine material back to Earth. This space mission is being led by the University of Arizona. The PI of the mission, Dante Loretta, is a colleague of ours in the Lunar and Planetary Laboratory. The goals of the mission are captured in its name, OSIRIS-REx, which stands for Origins, Spectral Interpretation, Resource Identification, Security, Regolith Explorer Mission. Now, as we've discussed, there are millions of asteroids in the solar system. So how did we decide on this target for the mission? For the mission feasibility, we wanted to choose a target that was close to Earth, close to Earth's orbit, a so-called near-Earth object or near-Earth asteroid, within 1.3 astronomical units of the Sun. That's between the orbits of Earth and Mars. And we did this so that we could get there in a reasonable time frame. Next, the asteroid had to have an Earth-like orbit, meaning it had to have low eccentricity and low inclination. Then we needed a large enough object to be able to orbit safely. Small objects spin rather fast, and so any loose material at the surface can be flung off into space. Not something you want to happen when you have a spacecraft orbiting your asteroid. So we needed one that was larger than 200 meters in diameter. Of the asteroids meeting those criteria, only a handful are carbon-rich, meaning they're primitive and likely contain the original building blocks for life on Earth. Asteroid 101955 Bennu was chosen not only because it has all of these criteria, but because it has a potentially hazardous orbit. Every 6 years, Bennu comes really close to the Earth, within 300,000 kilometers. That's within the orbit of the Moon. And these close encounters give Bennu a high probability of impacting the Earth late in the 22nd century. The OSIRIS-REx mission launched to Bennu on the 8th of September 2016 from Cape Canaveral. After 2 years of spaceflight cruise, including an Earth gravity assist in 2017, the spacecraft caught its first glimpse of Bennu in August 2018. The OSIRIS-REx spacecraft rendezvoused with the asteroid in December 2018 and began an intense orbital campaign.
Before we arrive at Bennu, a detailed observation campaign of the asteroid using ground-based telescopes and radar was used to calculate a shape model of the asteroid and gain crucial information on its size, approximate shape, and surface roughness. Based on that data, we thought that Bennu will have a very flat, smooth surface, almost like a sandy beach. But that's not what we found. When the OSIRIS-REx spacecraft started imaging the asteroids on approach and while in orbit, it became clear that its surface is extremely rough, with many boulders, some of which have the size of a small house. The spacecraft also has a series of spectrometers that allow to get information on the chemistry and mineralogy of its surface. Some feature in the spectra around 3.4 microns wavelengths are diagnostic of carbon-rich minerals and organics. This is a false color map of the asteroid surface showing the distribution of carbon-rich material. Cooler color indicate low abundance of carbon, hotter region indicate abundant carbon. Clearly, carbon-bearing material is present all around the surface of Bennu, consistent with this being classified as a carbon-rich asteroid. Other spectral features are characteristic of water-bearing minerals, for example, around 2.7 microns wavelengths. This false color map showed the distribution of water-rich material all across the surface of the asteroid, confirming that not only Bennu is carbon-rich, but also a water-rich object, where the water is not free-flowing, but locked up in minerals and organics. Now that we knew that Bennu is enriched in both water and organics, the question is, where on this asteroid should we sample, and where would it be safe to do so?
As we said, the surface is extremely rugged, and so touching the surface safely was a big challenge. Moreover, the sample collection mechanism could only collect small fragments on the order of centimeter size or smaller. And so we had to search the asteroid for areas that had fine-grained material and that had enough space around them so that we could maneuver the spacecraft down to the surface and touch safely. The primary sampling site was called Nightingale and is located on the northern hemisphere of Bennu. The close-up image shows the size of Nightingale crater in comparison to the size of the spacecraft. While it looks pretty simple to land there, you can see that it was an extremely tricky maneuver to pull off. Imagine trying to touch down on a moving object and trying to touch in the diameter of a car parking space while you're operating your car-sized spacecraft from 325 million kilometers away. Here you see a video of the touch-and-go sample acquisition mechanism, TAGSAM, the event where we touched the surface of the asteroid. We punched the surface, and in punching, we collected our sample. Nitrogen gas is expelled from the canisters, and in doing so, releases regolith material, loose particles, into the TAGSAM head. You can see that it's engulfed and collected into the TAGSAM. After backing away from the surface of the asteroid, we took images of the TAGSAM head. If you look closely, you can see that the interior of the TAGSAM head is not closed properly, and this meant that material was actually floating out of the capsule and being lost to space. NASA decided that in order to preserve as much material as possible, that it would actually stow the TAGSAM head earlier than anticipated and forego the sample mass measurement. Based on analysis of pre- and post-tag imagery, we believe that we have considerable mass in the TAGSAM head, maybe it's even packed full, and that we've secured enough material to meet our mission minimum requirement of bringing 60 grams of material home.
Now that the sample are secure into the return capsule, the spacecraft remain in orbit around Bennu. It will image the surface once more around the sample site to see how the spacecraft actually affected the surface, and then it will leave the asteroid on May 10th and start its journey back to the Earth. The OSIRIS-REx spacecraft will return to Earth and release the sample return capsule on September 24th, 2023. The capsule will land and be recovered in the Utah desert. After its recovery, it will be transported to a mobile, clean facility for initial inspection of the capsule, and then airlifted to NASA Johnson Space Center in Houston, where the curation team will open the return capsule to have a first look at the sample. Along with the mission PI, Dante Loretta from the University of Arizona, the curation team will be the first people to see the sample, and will be able to directly start the initial characterization of the material. While 75% of the sample will be stored and preserved for future analysis, the remaining 25% will be available for analysis. After initial characterization of the sample at Johnson Space Center, small articles of sample will be sent on to researchers all across the world, including material that will come here at the University of Arizona.
At the University of Arizona, we are preparing for the return of Bennu materials in several ways. We are constructing new laboratory spaces and acquiring new state-of-the-art analytical equipment with which to make our measurements. We're also developing methods with which to handle small, dust-sized particles. We have already identified a group of meteorite samples that we think represent good analogs to Bennu based on the orbital campaign that's already happened, meaning that those analogs are carbon and water-rich. With those analog materials, we are testing and refining our protocols for performing coordinated analysis. Coordinated analysis involves different instrumentations that allow us to determine mineral chemistry, what minerals are there, the isotopic composition of those minerals, and also to determine crystallinity. Coordinated microanalysis of meteorites is becoming ever more important because we have a finite supply of those materials. This is going to be even more important for the analysis of Bennu samples, since we have very limited material coming back, and we can't go back and get more. So it's vital that we maximize the scientific impact and value of those samples through innovative coordinated measurements, like what we're planning to do here. Some of the work we'll be doing at the University of Arizona on the returned Bennu samples includes characterizing the modal abundance of components from the millimeter to submicrometer scale. In the search for Bennu water, we will characterize the nature of the matrix material that Pierre mentioned earlier. We will do this in a similar way to how we're already analyzing Bennu analogs. Because isotope analyses by nanosims is somewhat destructive, these measurements actually occur somewhat late in our analytical sequence. We'll be measuring the water content and isotopic composition, the deuterium to hydrogen ratio of water in Bennu samples. Bennu samples will help us unravel the fluid alteration history of the asteroid at the micrometer scale, that history that we already see so clearly from orbital imagery of Bennu. Because water and organics are so intimately mixed in the matrix of carbon-rich chondritic meteorites, we need to measure both in the sample. We do this in meteorites already, and we believe this is going to be crucially important in the returned Bennu materials. Again, we plan to analyze the sample returned using a combination of analytical techniques, characterizing the chemistry, minerals present, and organic molecules from the millimeter to submicrometer scale. Organic matter is easily recognized when you have the right spatial scale, as we do with the nanosims. Organics are easily spotted because they have extreme isotopic signatures. This means that when we measure a sample for carbon or hydrogen isotopes, the organics shine like glow sticks in the night, where the glow sticks are the organics and the night is everything else in the sample.
Together, the analysis of water and organics will help us to understand the role of fluids on asteroids and how matrix and organics interacted in the presence of fluids. Analysis of Bennu material will help us understand how it formed and evolved. Therefore, Bennu sample will not only help us retrace the formation and evolution of the asteroid itself, but also help us understand the nature of water on the asteroids and whether Bennu is a good analog for the delivery of bioessential elements to the inner solar system and the Earth. The combination of water and organics analysis we make at the University of Arizona will help us to say whether objects like Bennu may have seeded the Earth with bioessential elements. We are made of water, and water is all around us. Our interaction with water and how it affects us is the focus of the following talks.
Thank you for joining us for the first lecture in our series on water. We hope you can join us next week for our second lecture, Water Within the Ocean, with Diane Thompson. The oceans play a fundamental role in year-to-year patterns of temperature and water availability. We can see this in studies of the world's largest ocean and its evolution of patterns in response to the Earth's changing climate. Next week in her talk, Diane Thompson will discuss how we harness this historical information to develop and test innovative solutions for increasing the resilience of coral reef ecosystems at the Biosphere 2. Thank you to our presenting sponsor, Tucson Electric Power, and our series sponsors, Cost Communications, Halualoa Companies, Raytheon Missiles and Defense, Research Corporation for Science Advancement, Tucson Medical Center, and Visit Tucson. Your generous support is what makes this series possible.